Okay, folks, we're recording. So welcome again to Kabbalah Decoded. The topic of tonight's discussion is going to be the signature in the soul. Now, I think I have to explain that a little bit to you all, exactly what that means, but we will get there shortly. Everyone can hear okay? Yeah? All right, fine. Okay, so I was going to start off with a joke today, but unfortunately, due to the circumstances of today's event in California, maybe I'll leave it for a little bit later. The topic of tonight's discussion, the signature in the soul, what exactly does that mean? So, there is a statement in the, it's actually in the Mishnah. The Mishnah is like the part of the Talmud. It's the basic statement of Talmudic law and Talmudic dictum without all the discussion that revolves around it. In any event, the discussion of the Talmud says as follows, or the Mishnah in the Talmud says as follows, that a person, when he wants to make a coin, when he wants to make coins, so he makes himself a what's called a hoitem, he makes himself some kind of press in which he either pours the metal or he uses it to actually press out the coins or whatever. And the design on the coin that he makes is the same for all of the coins. Every coin is the same. It's supposed to weigh the same, look the same, same shape, same color, probably, same stamp on the coin. He makes himself a stamp or a die and he stamps out the coins, or some kind of mold into which he pours metal and so on and so forth. So that's how you make a coin. The Mishnah then goes on to say that's how a human being makes a coin. However, when it came to God making human beings, so he used the same die for everybody, and yet everybody's different. Each person is different. But nevertheless, the same die was used. So how could that be that everybody's different? Now, the word that we use for coin, the word for coin in Hebrew is the word matbeah. Matbeah is a coin. And the word matbeah really contains within it the word teva, nature. Teva, T-E-V-A in English, or I will write it actually into the chat if anyone's interested in seeing it. I can write it into the Hebrew as well. Teva. Or in English, teva. Put an H on there, it doesn't matter, whatever. Nature. So the nature of things in the world, there are some things in the world, in other words, that have a stamp that's more or less unchanging. There are other things that have the same stamp, in other words, you can see that they come from the same mold, but they're different. All slightly different. All human beings have their own individual fingerprint. As far as we know, no two people have the same identical fingerprint. Truth be told, no two people except identical twins really have the same DNA. Everybody has their own individual signature. Their own individual imprint. All human beings, nevertheless, each one has a different imprint. So Hasidic texts and Kabbalistic texts, based on this difference, explain that there's really two things going on over here. That the word teva, nature, can be used to describe the concept of it can be used to describe the concept of natural laws, which are really the same for anything and the same everywhere. In other words, for example, law of gravity. The law of gravity is a constant that doesn't really change. It doesn't matter where you are. The law of gravity still applies, right? You can be here, you can be on, on top of Mount Everest, you can be in other places. It's not going to change. Gravity is gravity. And the laws of gravity apply even on the moon, even though the gravity is much less because of the mass of the moon is much less than the mass of the earth. And other places there's much greater gravity, like on the sun, because of the greater mass and so on and so forth. The law is an unchanging law, basically. So too with the electrodynamic or thermodynamic forces and so on and so forth. There's six forces, in fact, within nature, which are apparently unchanging anywhere. There's a weak gravitational force, stronger gravitational force, weak nuclear force, and so on. There's all kinds of forces. I'm not a scientist, so I'm not going to go into them and explain them, etc. If anyone wants to look into it a little bit more, there's a very, very interesting book, although we don't necessarily agree with these conclusions. But there's a book, a very interesting book called Just Six Numbers. Just Six Numbers. Six numbers, six, the gravitational constant and the weak nuclear force and so on and so forth. He goes on, he explains all of them in that book. He's a accomplished scientist in any event. So there's certain things which are unchanging and the same everywhere and the same for everybody. But there are other things which change with each individual. These are also laws, so to speak, but the way they are manifested is different for each individual. Now, there was a story that I heard, a very beautiful story, actually, that a friend of mine, he's a businessman, but he also happens to be a public speaker, and he once gave a speech that I heard, and he told the following story. He was actually giving a speech, I think in Shanghai, if I'm not mistaken, but he was giving a speech to the corporation, the Mitsui Corporation, I believe it's called. Mitsui is a very big Chinese bank, and I think it's Chinese. In any event, he was giving the speech, and he was on the, as soon as he was taken in, he was ushered up to the top floor where the president of the corporation was there to greet him. The president of the corporation happened to be a South Korean man. Anyway, they greet and they speak for a few minutes, and then the South Korean man takes him over to a painting on the wall. And he says to him, this friend of mine, his name is Akiva, so they call him Kivi. So the man from the from Mitsui, the president of Mitsui Bank, says to this friend of mine, "Do you see this painting?" He looks at the painting, and he sees the painting. It's very well lit, and it's placed in a very strategic place, and it's, you know, it's sort of the focus of the room. You can hardly not see it, even though it's a pretty small painting. So he looks at the painting. He sees the painting. So the man says to him, the president of the bank, "How much do you think this painting is worth?" Now, this painting was a Picasso. A small Picasso painting, and this is the joke I was going to start off with, but I'll tell it now. a friend of mine was going out on a sort of a blind date. It's called a shidduch, and someone had made this date for him, and usually matchmakers and things like that, Orthodox Jews often go out on a sort of blind date, which is arranged by a matchmaker. Someone knows the girl, someone knows the guy, whatever. So the matchmaker, it's not a done deal. You go and you meet, and if you like each other, you meet again, and so on. More or less like a blind date, basically. Anyway, before he went on this blind date, so the matchmaker tells him, boy, I got a girl for you. Wow, she is just gorgeous, you know, a work of art. So anyway, he goes and he meets the girl, and she's not very attractive at all. And so on and so forth. So they have a nice time, but whatever, but she's the opposite of attractive, you could say. He goes afterwards to the shatran, to the matchmaker, and he says to him, you know, you told me she was gorgeous. He said, she's a picture, she's a painting, she's a work of art. They said, yeah, Picasso. Picasso. So anyway, the so this friend of mine was up on the 20th floor of the Mitsui building, and he's looking at this Picasso, and the manager of the bank, president of the bank, says to him, he says, Kiwi, Mr. Kiwi, tell me, what do you think this painting is worth? So he says, worth, you know, how do I know? It's he's thinking to himself, I don't know, it's probably a few hundred thousand dollars at least. So he says, I don't know, maybe $700,000-$800,000, he guesses. It's a small little painting. So the guy said, no, not how much insurance we pay per year, how much painting worth. So he says to him, obviously, if makes a quick calculation in his head, that's what he's paying for the insurance. He figures, well, it must be worth, I don't know, maybe 10, 12 million. So he suggests 10, 12 million. And this conversation goes on. Eventually, he finds out that the painting is worth 21 point something million, 21 and a half million approximately. Now the line of questioning gets a little bit different. The president of the bank says to him, Mr. Kiwi, why is this painting so expensive? So my friend is trying to figure out what's he asking? Like, why is it so expensive? Because that's, you know, that's Picasso. So you know, it's not particularly gorgeous, it's not particularly pleasing to the eye, but it's a Picasso. So he questions him backwards and forwards, trying to get him to figure out, like, what is it that about this painting that is so special? What is the specialness of this painting? And eventually, my friend, like, he's a little exasperated already, he says, well, why don't you tell me, Mr. Kim, why don't you tell me what's so special about the painting? Which is the opportunity that he was waiting for. And he says, oh, you see, you look in the bottom corner of the painting, it says Picasso, the signature. Without signature, painting worth nothing. Without the signature, the painting is worth nothing. It's true. And the same thing is true here. Without the signature in the soul, what would the soul be? Now, what is the signature? We said that there's two kinds of signatures. There's sort of the signature, which is the unmoving, unchanging, alike for everything signature. In other words, like a signet ring, when you push it into wax, or you know, you sign with a signet ring. The kings of old used to sign with a signet ring. They would make some kind of, they would pour hot wax onto a document, and would take their signet ring and press the ring into the wax, and that would, you know, show the royal seal. And the royal seal was identical for all documents. Why was the royal seal identical? Because the ring was the same ring. They used the same signet ring. So the signature was the same for everything. But in the soul, the signature is not the same for everybody. And this is what we really have to understand now. What is this concept of the signature in the soul? There's a verse in the famous Song of Songs. Song of Songs was written by Shlomo HaMelech, King Solomon. And in Song of Songs, the Jewish people ask, it's a dialogue. The Song of Songs is a dialogue between Jewish people and God. And it goes backwards and forwards. And one verse, the Jewish people speak. Next verse, the next stanza, God speaks. And it goes backwards and forwards. Whole discussion. So, one of the verses reads as follows, and one of the stanzas reads as follows, that the Jewish people say to God, place me as a sign upon your heart. Place me as a sign upon your heart. In other words, remember me, keep me close to your heart. Place me as a seal upon your heart and upon your arm. So, what was the request? The request was that we should, so to speak, always be close to God's heart. In other words, he should be aware of us at all times and think about us at all times. And that's part of the idea. However, what we're asking is something different. What we're asking is, what is the concept of the signature of God within each person? If you have a look at modern science, the DNA, the human genome, you will find that the DNA is comprised of various strands. It's actually four strands. I believe that there are four sort of proteins which make up, the nature really of the DNA molecule, the DNA string. It's four proteins. I forget what they call them. The DNA is like kind of the software, and the proteins are sort of the hardware. They call them, I forget what the name, but the letters of these protein strands are A, C, G, and T. A, C, G, and T. They have four chemical bases for that appear in the DNA strand of a human being. So, in each individual, chemical bases in the DNA, even though it's a human genome, in each case, nevertheless, in a physical sense, although we're all human beings and we all share human DNA, nevertheless, each person's sequence or each person's DNA structure is slightly different from somebody else's, unless they're identical twins. That's in a physical sense. But just as you have in a physical sense, you have the concept of DNA, the DNA of the cell, which is the sort of the signature in the cell. In fact, there's a book called The Signature in the Cell. So just as you have a certain signature in the cell, in other words, like the signature of humanness in the cell, which is actually also called the divine stamp, but just as you have it in the human cell and human genome, so too you have it in the human soul. But there it's a much more elevated type of stamp. Someone asked over here, could I please relate the discussion to the Chochmah of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, which is called the seal of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Chosamo shel HaKadosh Baruch Hu is emes. The seal, God's seal is truth. Yeah, I'm getting to that. It'll take a while before we get there, but I will get to it. In any event, the concept of the divine seal within the human being is something which is unique to each individual, although we all share the fact that we have a seal in the soul, God's seal in the soul, so to speak. Now, what exactly is that seal? What exactly is that signature in the soul? That signature in the soul is explained in Hasidic and Kabbalistic works. That signature in the soul is each individual's particular purpose. His purpose in the world. And therefore, the signature in the soul of each individual is going to be a different one. Because each individual is going to have at least somewhat of a different purpose than anybody else. Otherwise, it wouldn't have been necessary to create him in the first place. Why would he have to be here if someone else is doing the same job? Now, it's explained in Kabbalistic works that although many people, it's possible that many people share a common soul root, the soul roots, there are only 600,000 soul roots. Without going to how we get exactly 600,000, I'm not going to go into it now, but there's only 600,000 soul roots from which individual souls derive and split off. Now, in these 600,000 soul roots, if you're talking about the soul root has each one of those 600,000 soul roots has its individual purpose. But when they split off, when the souls of all the people in the world, what is 7 billion, 8 billion, whatever it is now, 10 billion, I don't know, 13 billion, whatever it is, however many people are in the world today, we're all sharing only those 600,000 soul roots. And some are, so to speak, on a higher level of soul, because when one soul root splits off, it could split off into, let's say, four sections, let's say, for example, right? Splits off into four sections initially. And then each of those four sections might split into another four or another eight or another 16 or whatever it may happen to be. And each one of those, or at least some of those, will split further down into another 32 or whatever. I'm not saying exact figures here. I'm just giving an example. But some of them will still stay at the soul root of the first split, or perhaps the second split, or the third, etc., etc. Right? As the soul splits up, just as the cell splits up, as the soul root splits up, so the more it splits up, the more specific the person's task in this world, the more specific, unique to him it is, to him or her. And the more you go back towards the soul roots, the more sort of general it is. So we're all sharing in a certain sense, everyone who's from soul root number, let's say 504,333, let's say, is bound to a certain overarching task, the task of that particular soul root, but each one has its function within that particular that particular soul root. So you could, I suppose, describe it like this. Just as you have a system of sort of a banking system or a money system, let's say you have $100 notes, and then you have $20 notes, and then you have $10 and $5 and $1, and then you have quarters and nickels and dimes and nickels and pennies. Right. So on the level of penny, the buying power, the power of that soul, so to speak, is going to be less than the power of a $100 note. The achievement power of that penny is going to be less than the achievement power of a $100 note. But nevertheless, if that penny is not doing its job within the breakdown of the entire soul root, that particular soul root, if the penny's not doing its job, then the entire structure is missing something. Now, it goes on to explain in Kabbalah that a person can move from the state of penny to the state of nickel and then dime, so to speak. I'm only using an analogy over here. Then to the level of dollar and then to the level 10 and 12 and so on and so forth. Just as we find that biblically there were the regular in the biblical army in the desert with Moses, Moshe Rabbeinu, there were the regular foot soldiers, and then there were the what they were called Sarah Hamea, Sarah Elef, the officers in charge of 100, and officers in charge of 1,000, and officers in charge of 10,000, and so on and so forth, until you had on the top of the sort of at the top of the whole structure, you had Moses, sort of arranging and directing this whole entire army, so to speak. Now, when an army goes out on a duty as an army, it has a certain function that it's supposed to do, something that it has a mission as an army, army as a whole. But just as you have in a physical army, so you have some people are the scouts and some people are the are infantry, and some people are cavalry, what would be cavalry in the, you know, the armored units, and some people are air force, and some people are and so on and so on, all kinds of different things. And within the air force is all kinds of different things, within the army and the cavalry and so on. Each one of these are tanks and these are armored cars and so on. So everybody has their particular function and belong to their particular group. So too is it is with souls. We belong to particular groups and so on. But nevertheless, each soul, each individual has his particular function within that unit. If he's working well, he's doing his thing, it supports and bolsters all of the other members of the unit. And so the job gets done, and it gets done properly, and it gets done in the, usually in the, hopefully in the quickest and most painless possible manner. Now, if a person refuses to do his duty, so what happens? Just as you have in the army, someone who refuses to do his duty for whatever reason, so other people have to take over, they have to compensate. Unfortunately, what happens is when a person doesn't do his duty, so it can happen that that soul kind of gets lost. It gets, sort of court-martialed and put in jail kind of thing, and it doesn't, and that's an unfortunate situation that can happen to the individual soul. Sort of gets blocked off and becomes alienated and doesn't it doesn't feel itself to be part of a greater picture. An unfortunate thing. The most important thing that we have to realize, however, is that we do have this mission, so to speak, each individual in his own way, as part of a whole, but nevertheless, each one in his own way, has a mission which is called the signature in his particular soul. Now, someone asked a question over here. It would be great if everyone found their purpose in life and could share it with all other people. Now, it's not impossible to find out what your purpose in life is. It's based on what you're given. It's based on the talents that you have. It's based on your every person is given, since he was given a signature, so to speak, God's signature in his soul. So he was given particular talents and abilities and powers of soul that are unique to him or to her. Based on those unique talents and powers, etc., so based on those, he could figure out what his mission is in life, what he's here for, what he's supposed to be doing. And therefore, it's not impossible to find out. In fact, in my coaching practice, that's one of the things that I try to do, is to try to help people discover what it is that their particular mission and purpose is in life. So that idea is to go back to a question that was asked earlier. This, it says that the seal or the signature of God's signature is truth. God's signature is truth. Now, when we say that God's signature is truth, what does that mean? In the context of what we've been talking about, this means that when a person is following his mission in life, then the truth of that signature is revealed. In other words, what's the difference between a fake Picasso and a real Picasso? The fake Picasso might look almost identical to the real thing, but because it doesn't have Picasso behind it, but it's just some person who copied it, it's not, it doesn't fulfill its real function. It doesn't have, there's something that's missing there. Even if the signature's been copied very well, it doesn't have the value of the artist, of the original artist who did it. Similarly, when a person is doing a fulfilling a mission which is not his, when he's doing something which is not him or not her, it's also like, to a certain extent, it's a fake painting. It's fraudulent. It's not truth. When we say that the seal of God is truth, one of the things that we mean by that in this particular context is that the seal, the signature in your particular soul, reveals its value. It reveals its value in the sense that the mission that you've been given to do, the purpose of your life, is in fact what you're doing, and therefore the signature is a real one. The signature is real for you. And therefore, the person has that value of displaying an authentic signature, so to speak. Whereas if a person is simply copying somebody else and he's not finding his own authentic, original function and purpose and mission in this life, so although it might look like a banknote, it might look like a Picasso or a Rembrandt or whatever, it's not simply not following the he's not true to the signature that he has in his soul. Okay. Just to answer a question here, someone explains many years ago the soul is compared to a fire flame, just like lighting one flame from another flame. Not detract from flame, and also there's an infinite ability to keep blinding flame. Could you please explain all this in relation to the splitting of the souls? This is a slightly different approach over here. It's talking about a different thing. It's talking about the ability. The soul itself is called God's candle. In another context, the soul is called God's candle. Ner Havaya Nishmas Adam. Man's soul is God's candle, or actually, if we go according to the verse itself, it says God's candle is man's soul. And the sages say like this: my flame is in your hands, and your flame is in my hands. My candle is in your hands, your candle is in my hands. Our candle is in God's, our soul is in God's hands, but his candle, in other words, what we light the world up with, divine law, in other words, the Torah, Kabbalah, the teachings of the Torah, the ethical teachings, and so on and so forth, that's how we light up the world. So it fits in the sense that, the signature that a person has is what he's supposed to be doing in this world. In other words, lighting up the world, making the world a fitting place for the revelation of godliness in one way or another, whichever way is the person is designed, structured, minted, if you want to say, to be able to do, to light up the world in his particular corner of the world the way he's supposed to do it. And so that's when one does that, so he lights up all the other souls around him because, and it's an infinite thing, as you point out. Why? Because all the souls that are part of that that soul root, every soul enhances the other one. They don't compete; they enhance each other. When it comes to a state of competition where one person isn't doing any work whatsoever, and then the others have to pick up the slack, and then that can lead to a lot of interpersonal difficulties and so on and so forth, which we don't need to get into now. Okay, I hope that answers the question. So the main lesson to take away from what we've been talking about tonight is that each person has his uniqueness. That uniqueness is called God's signature in his soul. And that signature is what it is that God wants from you as an individual, what it is that you can accomplish in this world. And of course, just as the soul has a signature, I mentioned the body also has its signature adapted to the signature of the soul. The signature of the body, since the body is the vessel for the soul, therefore the vessel is there in order to be able to perform what it is that the soul's mission is. The body is given the powers and the abilities and the talents and so on and so forth that the soul needs in order to be able to fully perform its function in the world. It's the tool that the soul uses, so to speak. And that's in fact how to find out, to a certain extent, to find out what it is that our mission is, at least at a certain stage of life. So the idea, therefore, is that we have to get sort of, so to speak, familiar with that signature. We have to try and discover what it is that signature is telling us, and then act upon it. And when we do that, the world becomes a better place for everybody. Then it becomes, again, that becomes the concept of truth. We're following what it is that we're brought into this world to do. Okay, any questions?